I just want to talk to you just a second. I know a bunch of you probably got football games you're going to go to or whatever it may be, and I don't want to interrupt your evening in any way. But I do want to tell you this. We've got, you know, we've got a monstrous vote tomorrow. And it is, I really believe it's the biggest vote in the history of this state, hands down. And there's a lot of people who don't have a clue that it's even going on. I mean, it's the biggest thing I've ever seen in my life. I pulled into McDonald's at Caldwell the other day, and a guy got out of the car, and he was screaming at the top of his lungs. He was saying, "Go get him, Jim. I'm all behind you. You're doing great. You just keep on doing what you're doing. You're doing great." And I said, "Now, be sure and vote, you know, this coming on October the 7th. And he looked at me like I was an alien. And he said, "What are you talking about?" And I said, "Well," and then I went into the whole thing, but I know you run into the same thing. Now, how many of you have early voted?
Wow.
And that's a pretty good
mix. That's pretty good.
Now, the rest of you are going to vote tomorrow, right?
Right. Yeah. Right.
Okay. Now, y'all come on in here. Y'all go right there and get you some food. Don't y'all dare leave here. You see those little rascals right there? Our daughter Jill is getting ready to have Kathy and I's first grandbaby.
Oh.
And not for a couple more months, but December the 4th, which is really good. Yeah, that's right. We got a real scare the other day, too, because our doctor, OBGYN's in Charleston, and she was down, and everything checked out great, baby and her and everything. Then she went out to eat, you know, and her husband went to Outback, and just one of those things, but she knows they were mopping the floor or something, she slipped and fainted. Scared us all to death. Off to the hospital she went, and everything's okay, but it was scary. But anyway, my dear wife right here, Kathy, and lots and lots and lots of wonderful friends. This is Elsie, and Coach Pruitt's here, and you know, over and over and over, we have, not only that, we have at least one senator here, and I know we've got at least one delegate here, and if they could stand, let's give them, if there's anybody else here, y'all tell me, because I don't know, but anyway. Care. You know, now think about this just for a second. I had the great honor of being in here, and this place was wall to wall, packed all the way forevermore, and there was 500 or 600 of you in here, and we gave you a lot of notice on this go-round, didn't we? Like 3 hours. But we do appreciate you coming, and you know, when I was here and I was just a candidate and everything, I told you at that time, and I'd tell you the same thing today, that I didn't do this for anything for me. And I still stand right in that same position. I really genuinely want goodness for our state. And I mean that with all my soul. And I tried, great goodness gracious, did I try. You know, when we went through the process of the session. And at the end of the day, what we ended up with, there's no point in throwing rocks at anybody, and hopefully not at me, but y'all don't have any rocks, do you? Good. Well, that's okay. That's okay. You know, but at the end of the day, I hate to tell you the truth, but it's just facts. We didn't get anything done.
No,
and
you haven't given up yet,
though. Of course I haven't given up. What do you think I'm doing here?
Amen.
But we didn't get anything done to where we could have helped a lot of people. A lot of people. And it broke my heart in a lot of ways because I worked, like I said, I worked like a dog. And I felt like I had it done. And then for whatever reason, we just dove in the ditch and it didn't get done. And then everything unraveled. lot you don't even know. But at the end of the day, the only money that we put into the system, and you see, we started out, now let's be fair. When I walked into the party, we had a $500 million hole in the bucket. Now we did, for good or for bad. And we had also drained our rainy day fund down to where you couldn't take any lower because your bonds were being derated. Now that's happened, that happened. So what are you gonna do? I mean, you got, here's what you can do. You can put it all on your backs and just start cutting everywhere. Now you can, you really can. Well, I didn't want to do that, you know, and so because I felt like all that would do is drive more people out of West Virginia. And so at the end of the day, we worked. And there was a lot of good people on both sides that really compromised, believe it or not. And we got to crunch time, and then we got in a typical political food fight, and everybody pulled their offer off the table, and you got nothing except one thing. Well, you got real improvement in education, some things that helped the teachers and some things like that. And the other thing you got was you got an idea that was this idea about the roads. You got past the funding to do the roads, which was enormous. We've gotten that done. So all the taxes are in place and done. This hocus pocus that people have told you there's going to be, you're going to have to raise your taxes, that's not one ounce true. In all the world, there's not one thread of truth to that. None. Zero. All the funding is in place and it's right there. Now you got that passed right there, that passed, which was a gigantic thing. You got real help to education and that was a big thing. But other than that, the only money that was put into the system was a forecast, like a check that wasn't signed. And it was a forecast of what will happen to the economic gain to the state once you start the roads. That's all we did. Now that was it. And Stephen and Glenn will attest to that until the cows come home. So, you still got a state that's probably still losing population, maybe not right now, because we're starting back. We really are. Now, I see it in the community. I see it as a Dairy Queen. I see it everywhere, where people are not only smiling about the dip cone, but they're smiling about something else. You know, they're really smiling, you know, a little anyway. And I see it, you know, driving through, looking at the car lots, looking at the people walking around. The coal business is a little better. We don't know if it's going to stay forever, but it's surely a little better today. And I see it in whether you like him or don't like him, in the Trump administration. Donald Trump is my friend. And all those people that are there, you know, lots of them are really trying for West Virginia, believe it or not. You know, and why, I can't really answer that other than he liked the people when he was here, and he surely knows that I'll hit him in a headlock if he doesn't help West Virginia. You know, now, we're good friends, but I want him to help West Virginia, and he's committed to do so. So now here's the problem. I can't see any downside to a yes vote. None. You tell me if all you got to do is check yes, and you're going to get roads, lots of roads. That number of projects right there and all that stuff is about 42 new projects and like 550 projects that are going to fix existing roads where you can't even get your car up and down the road. And not only that, the school buses are running on roads that are dangerous as they can be every day. What's it going to take for us to wake up to the next disaster? Well, we've lost a bunch of kids or something like that because the bus has gone off and who knows what could happen. Well, now, so the downside of a yes vote to me is zero, zippo. What's the downside of a no vote? What if this thing fails?
Nothing changes. Things get worse.
Here's the problem, here's what you got. You still got hundreds of millions of dollars of a deficit, meaning you got a hole of hundreds of millions of dollars you got to do something about. Now, if this fails, you still got the hole. And what are you going to do to fill the hole? Well, the only thing you can do, you can like me or not like me, but the only thing in the world you can do is cut stuff. Medicaid, DHHR, autism, you know, the veterans, the teachers, K-12, higher ed. It just goes on and on. You have nowhere else to go. That's why it is single-handedly the biggest vote in the history of the world. Now, you got a great mayor here, and her little hubby sitting back there smiling. And you know, what they do, I mean, I love them with all my soul. You know, and I thank them. But let's go back to that. Let's go back to, and that's why I've worked and been all over Kingdom Come till I'm blue, flat, green, and trying to tell people. All I'm trying to do is just educate you. I'm not trying to influence you. I'm just trying to educate you. If you vote no, are you willing to go up there and say, we've really got to do without free market? Are you willing to go over to Concord and say, we got to close you. I'm really sorry, we got to close you. Or are you willing to go to a senior center and just say, oh, I'm sorry, but we got to close this senior center? Are you willing to say to Medicaid people, a lot of people that are on Medicaid, we just can't quite fund it all? Are you willing to say the PEIA for the state workers and all that kind of stuff, we just have to go to a 60-40 plan instead of an 80-20 plan? You're not willing to do all that. And gosh knows, if you do that, the next thing you better do is somebody better be designated here to be the last person out of the state to turn the lights out. Because that's what's going to happen. Now, we'll survive somehow. We always have. But really and truly, we have always been dead last, too. A no vote will ensure that your roads are going to get worse. A no vote will ensure you got a hole in the bucket and there's going to be gigantic cuts. Gigantic cuts. Or, God forbid, a no vote would, the only way you could get out of the hole would be drastically raise taxes. Now, that's all with a no vote. Now, with a yes vote, here's what will happen. You'll get your roads fixed. There'll be hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars pour into this state, pour right into this county, and fix roads and build roads in every county, all over the place.
Be good.
My gosh, 11, you'll get so tired of seeing orange and white cones, you'll dream about it. Because they'll be all over the place. And the roads will get fixed. And the school buses will move safely. And we'll pray and hope and pray beyond belief that always they'll move safely. Now, let me tell you this, in addition to that, think about what will happen if you create 48,000 new jobs. You know what's going to happen more than anything? And I want y'all to really dial into me on this and listen to me. Everybody here knows probably a family member or a friend's family member that had to leave West Virginia to go get a job. All of us know people that left to go get a job. Well, we can bring those people home. We can reunite those families. We can absolutely, they want to come home. All they wanted was a good job. And they love West Virginia as much as we do. And they wanted to come home. Well, now you got a chance to bring them home. Now, the other thing you got on top of that is you've got so many more people working than we have today, the revenue goes up. As the revenue goes way up, you build more schools. You help the vets. You help the old and the sick. You do what government's supposed to do. There's so many things at this, and you get the roads fixed. You get to be able to drive to the convenience store without tearing your car all to pieces. You know, now, I've got to watch more than anything the state police. Now, this didn't get out till today, so I might as well go ahead and tell you because it's out everywhere because the guy down at the Capitol asked me about it today. One of my troopers, because I'm running everywhere, and I went to five places in the Eastern Panhandle, and one of my troopers had to take my car, because I drive everywhere, had to take it to Kaiser. So they asked me, because I flew up there, I got in real late the night before, flew to Kaiser, and then I started driving again, okay? And so when I got there, the whole front end of my car is tore all to pieces. And so they asked me about it today in Charleston. They said, tell us what happened to your car. And I'm talking about it in the news conference. You know, now I'm on live TV. And I thought, well, I can't explain my way out of this one and everything. And so the bottom line is that he plowed right into a deer. Point. And in the front of my car right now, there's still hair sticking out there. And so he said with lightning quickness, he almost missed the deer. I said, how could you have hit it more dead center? I mean, the whole car's torn. But nevertheless, I didn't even find out about if they got the deer. But listen, these guys take care of me, and they do wonderful work, and they look after you every single day. Now, how grateful are we to all them, all the first responders that were in Las Vegas, all the people that charge into our homes when there's a fire or a building? And can you imagine, can you just imagine if two people were arguing like crazy. They started shooting at each other, a man and a woman, and they called and they said, come out to our house and get this straightened out at 3:00 in the morning. I'd say, I'll be out there tomorrow morning sometime. Y'all just go ahead and have at it for a while. You know, no, but they come. They always come. And we should really be really indebted as to our vets. Now, I'm here. I want to hear somebody ask some questions, and I'll answer any question that you choose to ask as best I can. Yes, ma'am.
Governor, I want to know if you can assure us that these jobs are going to go to local West Virginians, or are you going to contract these jobs out to other workers in other states?
Okay, that's a great question. And I've been asked that a bunch of times. Here's the answer. 2/3 of these projects are funded with state bonding and state money, okay? And on those projects, the West Virginia Jobs Act has to be enforced. That means 75% of those jobs have to go to West Virginians. On the 2/3 of all this, $3 billion of work. So $2 billion of it, 75% of the jobs have to go to West Virginians, provided that they don't apply for a waiver because they can't get anybody to qualify to take the job. You know, they can't pass a drug test or whatever it may be. Now, there's another problem. Let's say that because with this amount of jobs, no way they can all be filled by West Virginia. Let's just say that 70% of them are, or 60% of them are. You know, now what's happened in the past, and it's not gonna happen now, because absolutely, I'll sit on people about this, is out-of-state contractors have brought in out-of-state workers and not paid their payroll taxes and stuff. Well, we just let them slide, and we just don't need that, no matter what. But even if they do, even if we do have a percentage of out-of-state workers doing some of the work, we don't want that. I want every job to be a West Virginian. But I can't do it because we don't have enough West Virginians to do it right now. You know, and as we go, every day that goes by, once we tell the world we got the jobs and everything else, every day that goes by, we'll have more and more and more. And that more and more and more creates all kinds of goodness. But even if we could, let's dwell on just this. Let's think of one job, and it's an out-of-state worker. If we collect payroll taxes, he stays at a motel and we get a bed tax. He buys gasoline here and we get gasoline tax. And if he goes to Kroger's or goes to Walmart or something like that, we get that tax. So we're getting real money from him if we do it right. And he's out of state. He's an out-of-state guy. And in addition to that, he may just decide, you know, best place I've ever been in my life. And I want to live here. And then he brings his family here. And then we get even more. And on top of all that, we get the road fixed. You know, now, here's the question to all of us. And this is a great question. Wouldn't it be nice to wake up tomorrow and have too many jobs for the number of people we got? God Almighty knows. That'd be the greatest thing in the world could happen. You know? Now, but in addition to that, what if I just rolled in here and all these jobs could very well be 48,000 jobs? What if I came in tonight and I said, tell you what I got. I didn't quite get 48,000 jobs, but I've got 29,000 jobs that can all go to West Virginians. And I've got 29,000 West Virginians that'll take them. And I've got $1.9 billion that I'm going to just give you. Do you want it or not? Well, I mean, my gosh, we'd all jump through a hoop and say, gosh, happy days, happy days, happy days. So what I'm saying to you is the worst case scenario is just that. 70% of jobs are filled or 60% of jobs are filled with West Virginians, and it keeps on going. I'll promise you every single West Virginian, guarantee you this, every single West Virginian that can do a job and can pass a drug test will get the job. Guarantee you that.